empanadas, or they ask me what's an empanada, and I do have enjoy sharing that.
Adrian Espinoza, making and selling empanadas in Portland, Maine. About which two things? Number one, I'm hungry now. Number two, we cannot do this series without you. So let us know what's going on. Would you? Marketplace.org/myeconomy. Coming up,
we just want to know what to do when we get to the end of the meal.
Tipping is only the beginning of the end of the meal. First, though, let's do the numbers. Yeah, the Wawa's. Dow Industrial's off 475 today, 1.25%, 37,983. The NASDAQ descended, tumbled, fell, cratered, take your pick, 267 points, 1.6%, 16,175. The S&P 500 dropped 75 points, about 1.5% there. Ended things at 51.23. For the week, the Dow shed 2.4%, the NASDAQ dip 0.5%. S&P 500 fell 1.6% today. So, what do you have going on this weekend? Anything? Maybe thinking about a trip to a museum? Well, a 2018 study by the American Alliance of Museums found that museums contribute more than $50 billion a year, $50 billion a year, to the U.S. economy. That's a lot of purchases at the gift shop, am I right? That number also includes $12 billion a year in tax revenue paid to local, state, and federal governments, by the by. Bond prices rose, yield on the 10-year T-note down to 4.52%. Not down a lot, though. You're listening to Marketplace.
Marketplace is supported by Deloitte. Advancing the future takes more than a business angle or a technology angle. It takes both. Learn more at Deloitte.com/US/engineering advantage. And by KeyBank, a source for actionable information on trends that matter. Users can find insights on topics like healthcare, sustainability, economic conditions, technology trends, and cybersecurity at key.com/trending topics. And by the Peter G. Peterson Foundation, a nonpartisan organization dedicated to raising awareness and accelerating action on America's fiscal challenges to build a brighter economic future for the next generation. Learn more at pgpf.org.
Support for WNYC comes from
Highland Electric Fleets. Highland is on a mission to make electric vehicles more accessible and affordable for schools and communities everywhere. Learn more at highlandfleets.com.
On this week's On the Media, what happened to the offbeat, irreverent, speaking truth to power alt-weeklies that used to populate newsstands across the country?
The Voice was a guide to life from people who cared about what they were covering with such intensity that there were fistfights and brawls inside the paper. That's gone.
The end of an era on this week's On the Media from WNYC. Tonight at 9 or Sunday at 10 on 93.9 FM.
You're listening to Marketplace on WNYC. In the 7 o'clock hour of All Things Considered, the WNBA draft is coming up on Monday. It will be at the Brooklyn Academy of Music. We'll talk with the founder of Ladies Who Hoop, a free group for women of all ages who want to play basketball, about the draft and what she's looking forward to. That and more at 7.
This is Marketplace. I'm Kai Rizdahl. If, as seems likely, the Fed keeps interest rates where they are for a while, that means money is going to stay relatively expensive for a while. And that is going to have some knock-on effects for consumers and companies, both of which borrow, take on debt, right? There was a study out from S&P Global Ratings this week on the topic of corporate debt, one slice of it in particular, defaults, which are on the rise, and there's an accompanying rise in redefaulters. Marketplace's Kimberly Adams explains.
According to S&P, the number of defaults was up 80% in 2023, the fastest increase since 2008. But within that trend,
over one-third of the defaults we saw in 2023, and again are seeing in 2024, are companies that have already previously defaulted.
Nicole Serino is Director of Credit Research and Insights at S&P Global and says some of these companies are defaulting 2, 3, 4, some up to 5 times.
This tells us that there is a group of highly leveraged companies where restructuring after that initial default may not have sufficiently addressed the company's secular or operational challenges.
But the defaults she's referencing here aren't necessarily tied to bankruptcy and closure.
There is also another kind of default.
Cristiano Zazzara teaches finance at NYU's Stern School of Business and points out a lot of these multiple defaults come out of what are called distressed exchanges, where companies often just default on a portion of their debt.
But they tend to restructure their capital commitments, their financial structure, and then tend to stay in a weak situation also in the future.
But even though there has been a sharp increase in companies not paying up, the overall default rate for companies S&P tracks is still less than 4.8%, fewer than 200 companies. In Washington, I'm Kimberly Adams for Marketplace.
True story. Got an email from my accountant last night about some documents I'd forgotten to send him. Timestamp on that was 9:58 p.m. Wrote him back this morning a little bit before 5. Not 2 minutes later, he answered evidence, in case anyone needed it, that accountants are working some very long hours ahead of tax day on Monday. Complicating the long slog of tax season, for accountants mostly, not the rest of us, is that we are in the middle of an accountant shortage, and not just the ones who do taxes. Companies that are looking to hire CPAs and others in that industry are trying to figure out how to create a new generation of accounting professionals, as Marketplace's Elizabeth Trovall reports.
With so many accountant baby boomers retiring, Michael Decker with the American Institute of CPAs is looking at younger generations.
We're trying to change the messaging around accounting.
CPA, not certified public accountant, but
coolest profession around.
The industry is trying to reverse the decline in college students studying accounting with incentives like scholarships and a new pilot program.
The young employee can get their education for licensure, they can work, and then they're preparing for the exam at a low-cost credit hour.
In Texas, University of Houston professor Mohan Kuravilla is trying to get accountants into high school classrooms in his role with the Texas Society of CPAs.
It is not just about talking about the opportunities of accounting. It's also providing a platform to be a mentor to these students.
He says this can be especially valuable for first-generation college students who may not have grown up with an accountant in the family like he did.
Just like I saw my father and the lifestyle he provided us, just showing them the person you are and what you do will transform their lives.
And mentorship can also play an important role in retention, says Brandy Britton with the talent firm Robert Half.
If you have a mentoring program, that really serves your newer generation workforce very well because they like that coaching, etc.
She says other education, like work conferences, can help too. I'm Elizabeth Trovall for Marketplace.
Go out to eat. Time comes when you get the bill and you have to decide 18%, 20, 22. Whether you know it or not, you're a player in a delicate policy dance going on right now. How and how much waitstaff and cooks and bartenders ought to be paid. It's technically called the tip credit system, where restaurants, the employers, right, don't have to get their workers pay up to minimum wage if tipping can do it. There are moves afoot, though, to change that, to get restaurant staff up to minimum wage tips or no. And Washington, D.C. has become something of a test case. Marketplace's Sabri Benishore has part two of this story.
Washington, D.C. is where Brian has been working in restaurants for 16 years, here at this pizza place and at a fine dining restaurant. I caught up with him on Zoom.
Yeah, it's my full-time thing. I've been in the restaurant industry since I was like 18.
We're just going with Brian because he says the two restaurants where he works would fire him for talking to a reporter. In 2022, voters in D.C. approved a ballot measure that would eliminate the tip credit.
I was definitely in favor.
Since it has started to come into effect and restaurants are having to cover more of D.C.'s soon-to-be $17.50 minimum wage, Brian has noticed some changes. One big one, fewer workers.
In the era of that cheap labor when they were paying, you know, $3-4 an hour, you know, they would really stuff the floors with a lot of staff, a lot of hands. Now it is leaner crews.
Data back up that observation. Shortly after the phase-out of the tip credit started in D.C. last year, employment at sit-down restaurants started to fall sharply, according to state-level data from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. 3,200 jobs were cut. That's more than 10% of the peak workforce that year.
So that's consistent with the same type of analysis that we did.
David McPherson is a professor of economics at Trinity University, and a decade ago, he studied the effects of requiring restaurants to cover more of their employees' minimum wage instead of letting some of it be covered by tips.
That lowered employment. Either employees are going to get reduced, prices are going to go up, or profits are going to get reduced. One of those three things has to happen.
Or all of them.
Prices have definitely gone up at restaurants.
John Gold is part of a dining club in the D.C. area. Restaurant inflation in D.C., after being lower than the national average for a few years, is now higher than average after the tip credit phase-out began. Restaurant inflation is now at 4.2%. That does not capture service fees that many D.C. restaurants have been tacking on, much to the ire of customers.
Is that essentially an included gratuity that goes to the workers? Is that something else and we're supposed to tip on top of that?
It's not always clear. As a diner, Gold would prefer the prices just rise to reflect the wage people are paid.
People love the restaurant scene here. We want to see restaurants thrive. We also want to see workers make the wages that are fair and appropriate and that they ought to make. We just want to know what to do when we get to the end of the meal.
The Barcelona Wine Bar in D.C. is one restaurant that has resisted service fees for exactly this reason. And CEO Adam Halberg has other concerns about raising prices.
Raising prices is going to create a split where the restaurants in D.C. are going to become a lot more expensive to go to than the restaurants outside of D.C.
Not just for diners, but restaurant operators, too.
Those new restaurants are going out of the district right now.
Still, for now, the number of restaurants has continued to grow in D.C.
Right, and that's exactly why I'm totally, you know, okay with it.
Again, Brian, the server. He says he isn't actually making more money, but with leaner staffing, his job has become more reliable.
I do feel like it's definitely a lot more stable than it once was. Like, I definitely feel like I can guess what I'm taking home, and it is, you know, a respectable amount.
But one person's stability is another's inflexibility. Joseph, the waiter in New York from part one, isn't counting on waiting tables as a career. He wants to be an actor, and his erratic but flexible schedule lets him audition.
It works well for people who, for like myself, where this is not my primary pursuit. But other people who, I know a lot of people who support like their entire lives and their families through which like this could be a relief.
With a dozen states mulling this question of how tipped workers should be paid and who pays them, the jury is still very, very out. In New York, I'm Sabri Benishour for Marketplace.
Marketplace is supported by Brigham Young University, helping prepare graduates who are motivated by love to serve, lift, and lead. Brigham Young University, for the benefit of the world.
This final note on the way out today, which comes with the observation that Fridays, for most of us, are work days for now. There was a survey of CEOs out from KPMG earlier this week, saw this on CNN, that said 30% of big American companies are toying with the idea of a 4 or a 4.5 day work week. I, for one, will allow that. Our theme music was composed by BJ Lederman. Marketplace's executive producer is Nancy Fargali. Donna Tam is the executive editor. Neil Scarborough, and the guy who gets to decide if we work 4 days a week, is the vice president and general manager. I'm Kai Rizdal. Have yourselves a great weekend, everybody. We are back on Monday, all right? This is APM.